Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed a pleasure to see this building, this room filled with young people. We're so happy to have you here tonight. Thank you for coming. I know you're going to be a wonderful audience because you're going to hear a wonderful presentation from a gentleman who has a lot of experiences, life experiences to share with you. So I suggest and I urge you to keep notes and write down questions that you certainly will have an opportunity to ask him at the close of his presentation. Ambassador Perkins, we're happy to have you with us this evening, and we want to extend to you a very, very warm University of Arkansas, a Pine Bluff welcome. I also extend that same welcome to you, to the audience. Ambassador Perkins, and I'm going to add welcome home to that because of the fact that we know, and some of you have done some research, we know that he spent some time here in Pine Bluff at Merrill High School. I'm sure he will share some of that with you, and I encourage you to perk up your ears and be sure, if you don't do anything else after you leave, you're going to ask him some questions. Read his book, Mr. Ambassador, A Warrior for Peace. In that book, I believe it is that he talks about coming to Pine Bluff at age 14 and the impact that that experience at Merrill High School had on his life, his outlook on life, his perspective, and even his interest in opening up doors for people of color. This is the book, Warrior, Mr. Ambassador, Warrior for Peace. So be sure, it's a must read. You have to do that. It's something that you're going to put on your list, you're going to remember for as long as you live. At this point on the program, we'd like to have Ms. Brianna Allen, the current Miss University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, to come forward and extend a greeting not only to Ambassador Perkins, but to you, the audience.
To Chancellor Lawrence B. Alexander and his cabinet, students, faculty, staff, and friends, and our distinguished guests, Ambassador Edward J. Perkins. Good evening. I am the 86th Miss University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, Brianna Allen. It is my pleasure to be with you this evening. The University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff prides herself in academic and leadership excellence, so we are privileged to have accomplished an honorable gentleman here with us this evening. On behalf of the students at the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, I welcome you to a wonderful evening with Ambassador Edward J. Perkins. Thank you.
That's just a taste of what we have here at the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff. Thank you, Brianna, so much. And now, I'm sure that you have noticed that two of the sponsors of Ambassador Perkins are people from Merrill High School and also the alumni chapter of Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity. I'd like for Dr. Rope, who is a friend, I think, and who knows who some of those Merrill people are, to come forth for just a moment and introduce and acknowledge some of the Merrill people who are here tonight. Dr. Rope.
Thank you. Once again, students, we are so happy to see you, because you are our future. When you look at me and perhaps some others on stage, you realize that we're going to exit. And with you coming along, getting the basic values that have always been at this university, I know that we're going to leave this community and communities across this nation in good hands. My responsibility is to have the Merrill group that is here. Will all of the Merrillians please stand so the ambassador can see you? Ambassador, these are some of the same people that will thank you so much that walked the halls at Merrill. Now, many of you are a little younger than I am, and at one time, Pine Bluff had three black high schools, Merrill, Townsend Park, and Coleman. Corbin, but Corbin was here on campus.
Southeast
has come along, yes. And Southeast is, now I see, all of the Southeast people, please stand up. All of you. Yes. See, I don't want to stand up here and get my Southeast buddies upset, because there were a number of times that they hurt the Tigers a little bit on the field. I admit that. But it is so wonderful for us to have in our presence a man who came along, and I'm going to be through in a minute, but I just, Ambassador, please, Carolyn, just let me say this. He came along at a time when there were so many doors that were closed to us as a community, as a people. And we were constantly reminded that we just couldn't do certain things. We just couldn't achieve certain goals. And so we have with us today a person who came along when things were difficult. But because he believed in his family, because he believed in his teachers at Merrill, and later on when he got out of high school in Portland, because he understood that no matter what others said, he was somebody. And I don't want any of you out here in this audience to ever believe that the naysayers, that those who we believe are pundits, that say you can't achieve. He is a living testimony. No, it's not just in his book. When he walks on this stage, this is a living testimony of what can be done, even when you're told you can't do it. And that's why I'm so proud. And Carolyn, I'm through now, but I want these kids, look at this man carefully. You can be where he is if you get it right, keep yourselves cleaned up, get your grades, achieve, and become focused. He is a living testimony to what you can do. In spite of what they say, don't believe them. You got him here. You can tell all of them. I went and I saw him with my own eyes. I know what I can do. Thank you.
Thank you, Cliff. And only Dr. Rope could have said it in that manner and with that impact. Thank you so much. He's telling you the truth, and I'm sure that you heard him quite distinctly. And now I'd like to present, it's my honor and distinct pleasure to present to you our dynamic and energetic leader here at the university, Chancellor Lawrence Alexander, who will introduce our speaker.
Thank you, Dr. Blakely. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
So happy to have all of you here this evening. I'm delighted that you took the time out to come on this evening for this great event, for this great occasion, to experience greatness when it is among us. And we are delighted, pleased to have with us today, member of our Board of Trustees, Dr. Steve Broughton, thank you, to have our distinguished elected officials with us here today, I see several in the room, to have with us graduates of Merrill and other schools, all the other schools, Systematic College, and I am delighted to welcome all of you, and especially to all of our students in the room. Thank you for coming. We appreciate your diligence, and I will just say some words of introduction about our special guest today. But I was going to say something that I thought was somewhat powerful and impactful, but Reverend Dr. Rolfe took the mic And he coveted. Thank you. But our young people, I want to reiterate the words of Dr. Rose, that there is nothing that you cannot do or cannot achieve. And you are not. Not to let anybody tell you any different, that there is nothing that you cannot achieve that you set your mind to. That there is nothing too hard for you to do and nothing too hard for God to do. The man I'm about to introduce today knows that with God, all things are possible, and there is nothing that is impossible. You know that you can do all things through Christ, who strengthens. Ambassador Perkins was born in 1928 in Sterlington, Louisiana, where he spent his early childhood before moving to Pine Bluff in 1942. Dr. Perkins attended Merrill High School for 3 years before leaving for Portland, Oregon. In 1945, it was at Merrill that he became aware of the situation in South Africa, and he learned of the apartheid system there, and he later went on to earn his bachelor's degree from the University of Maryland, Master of Arts, and doctorate from the University of Southern California. He did his military duty in the U.S. Army. He served in the Marine Corps. He's held several positions, the U.S. Department of State and the Foreign Service. He had a stint as ambassador in Liberia. He served where President Ronald Reagan had appointed him as ambassador to South Africa. 1982, President George H.W. Bush named Dr. Perkins the 19th U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations. President Clinton appointed him as U.S. Ambassador to Australia, where he served until 1996, retiring at the rank of career minister in the U.S. Foreign Service. He has received in his career numerous awards of distinction, including the Presidential Distinguished Meritorious Service Awards, and the Department of State's Distinguished Honor and Superior Honor Awards. He holds membership in a number of distinguished organizations, including Kappa Alpha Psi, including he is my brother in the Sigma Pi Phi Boulay, and various other organizations. He has had assignments that have included the Jerry Collins Lecturer in Public Administration at Florida State University, and has held the presidential appointment to the Presidential and Congressional Commission on Public Service. He served on the White House Advisory Committee on Trade Policy and Negotiation. He retired, as I said, with the rank of career minister in the United States Foreign Service in 1996. He is the author of Mr. Ambassador, Warrior of Peace. We are grateful to share with you this evening and to be here on this auspicious occasion to welcome to our stage Ambassador Edward J. Perkins. Ladies and gentlemen, on your feet, let's welcome to the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, Ambassador Edward Perkins.
I just want to hope you'll forgive me for sitting. Well, the one thing I've learned as I celebrate my birthdays, certain parts of the body give out. In spite of what I do to keep it going. But nevertheless, I think what I should say tonight is being in front of an audience such as you the young future of a part of the United States. People who represent what our country is to continue to become. I think all of you probably recognize and will admit that we are never at the finish line as we develop our country. Important fact, we are always pushing for the finish line. It's right and proper that we think we've got the answer at your age. I felt the same way when I was your age as well. Well, maybe I did have the answer, but the proof of that is in what I have done for what I call the community. So this evening, I'm grateful to the Chancellor and to his team for inviting me to talk with you for a few minutes this evening. As some have said, I lived in Pine Bluff for a couple, 3 years, and it was kind of an accident that I happened to be here. My mother, married to a minister, accompanied him to a new post in the Northwest, in Portland. My mother asked me if I wanted to stay in school at Merrill for another for the year, and then join them at the end of the school year. And I said yes. In retrospect, after I said that, I said, "Well, you said yes, but what are you going to do? Where are you going to stay? And who is going to get you into church on Sunday?" I didn't have the answer to that, but my mother did. And she, of course, laid out plans for me. The time I spent in Pine Bluff, Arkansas, was probably, without a doubt, if not the most, then certainly one of the most valuable periods of time in my life. When I look at Pine Bluff in 1944, 45, or 43, and compare it physically with what it is today, I am then happy to see so many young people in this audience tonight, because what happens to Pine Bluff from now on is in your hands and in the hands of people like you. And when you deal with growth, it's the way of the future. And I hope you're up to it. I hope you realize that our nation is always at crisis points, trying to make a deal, trying to be better as we are now. I stayed in Pine Bluff in a boarding house, no relatives around, but I found out the next day that there were a number of people who were watching me. Many of them were church people, some were close to being Cavaliers and the same age. They all had one thing in mind: we want you to make it, and that you do not end up being a disgrace to your family. Well, I didn't really have time to get in trouble, because there was always somebody around, either on the streets, or at church, or at school. I also want to give thanks and appreciation to what I consider to be the best high school teacher program anywhere in the world at that time. These teachers, Stevens, Palmer, Adams, and others laid out a program for me that made me into something of a person looking for advantage, looking for a way to make sure that I could, quote, get over, unquote. They made me into something that I didn't think I could ever be. They gave me the confidence, real confidence, to be something different than I was at that time. I was born in rural Louisiana. I had a grandmother who tolerated absolutely nothing but excellence. Not only that, I remember the first time that I took the invitation of one of my classmates and went across the creek, so to speak, to a basketball game. And I had not told my grandmother and had not told my aunt. So when the time came for me to be home, I was someplace else. And to say that my grandmother and aunt were upset is to put it mildly. But my sponsor, one of my classmates, a few years older than me, when we finally got home, my grandmother and my aunt were at the door. And they thanked the man, the young man, for bringing me home. And they closed the door. And I never got out again without an escort from either my aunt or from my grandmother. It was a long time before I realized that they had my interest at heart. And they knew that if I didn't do that, I would not succeed. Grandmother couldn't read or write. She had books which had been saved from the time her 10 children, went to school. She made them give her the books. And she then used those books to make sure that the sister aunt who was at home would teach me the English language and all of its rudiments. So that when I finally ended up in high school, in Merrill, I was really ahead of the game. I didn't know it, but I was. These teachers also introduced me to many other kinds of issues. For example, the existence of the African National Congress, which was fighting an apartheid political system in South Africa, which separated all races. And teachers, especially the teacher who was teaching history again, ancient history, she said, we want you to save your pennies and your nickels so that we can make sure that we support the African National Congress in overthrowing, finally, this hateful regime. I didn't give it much thought after that. And years later, I was asked by President Ronald Reagan if I would take his nomination to be ambassador to South Africa with the express purpose of overthrowing the apartheid system. So at that time, I considered myself to be a little country boy, but I also learned that I had a pretty open mind and began to prepare for an assignment that I never hoped to have in my life. I'd been in the Foreign Service not all that long, but I'd had another assignment as ambassador for a couple of months. But that was not enough. President Reagan went to the bar and asked
the Secretary of State, George Shultz, I think the time has come to send a black ambassador to South Africa. Find somebody. Brother George Shultz said, let me find someone for you. And what he was looking for was a professional Foreign Service officer, someone who had spent years in the Foreign Service and who might come up with policies that he himself thought about and developed and carried out. I had not the slightest idea of what to do with this apartheid regime. But there was always something in my pathway, I guess. Some would call it the hand of the Almighty, and others would call it having an intuition. I don't know what it was, but somehow I found my way towards each objective that I had to carry out. And I think much of it was because of what I learned at Merrill High School from those teachers who would not take no for an answer and would never forget that their job was to teach me and others like me the concept of excellence and can-do-ism. A little bit about some of the things that made me a little bit different, I guess, or certainly prepared me for the kind of job that I asked for was what happened. How did I get the kind of daredevil activities? Well, as the person who introduced me said, I spent time in the Army. And when my time in the Army was up, I came out and came back to the United States, to Portland, and went back to school. Had a good program going in political science. But I was restless. One day, I asked a friend of mine who had been in the United States Marine Corps how I was, and he told me, he said, well, one thing for sure, they'll make a man out of you. So I said to myself, I want to go there. But first, I said, I wanted to go into the French Foreign Legion. I then went over to the Legion, which had its offices in the French Consul General's office in Portland, and signed up for the American Legion. But I couldn't take the oath of office until I got to Le Havre, France. I had no way of getting there. And so I joined the United States Marine Corps as a second alternative. I spent 4 years in the Marine Corps. It was probably the best decision I ever made in my life. I came out of it a better trained person in my mind as well as my body. I was posted to places like Hawaii, Japan, and to the northwestern part of the United States. More importantly, I found the Marine Corps was high on education. As a matter of fact, the sign on the door of the training officer was, it said, all training is for combat. In other words, you will be a better fighter if you are a better learner, better student. So I went into the Marine Corps, came out of the Marine Corps, and I was asked to go over to Annapolis and go to Bainbridge Prep School, and then go to Quantico, Virginia, and take the training to be a Marine officer. By that time, I had enough of this kind of regiment. I decided then that I needed to go back to school, get a degree, and move on with my life. I did that. And I never looked back since. But much of the impetus for that came from these teachers at Merrill High School. There's some other things I think I should tell you. Two of them I think are very important. And one of them is I learned that it's good to have a philosophy. I have two philosophies, and I've had it ever since I came out of the Marine Corps. One of those philosophies is called Bushido, which is Japanese for know yourself before you know anything else. Know who you are. That second philosophy concerns what you do with other people in terms of the respect you extend to them. And that Asian philosophy is always there under the title of Sun Tzu, who wrote The Art of War. I've been reading that book since I was in the Marine Corps. It's probably the handbook that means most to me. And each time I read it, I learn something new. Sun Tzu, The Art of War, and Bushido, which is the art of knowing thyself. Know who you are and what you can do. I think it's important that I tell you that being in the Foreign Service was also one of the best things that ever happened to me. It was a way to travel around the world, a way to get to know yourself, and a way to put into practice those things that you learned in school, in college. It's true that a Marine who is trained is a better Marine. So ultimately, I decided that being in the Marine Corps was, in fact, the best thing for me. And then I ended up in the Foreign Service. After training, I went to several posts, and I ended up, after 10 years in the Foreign Service, I was nominated to go to Liberia as the ambassador. I went through one coup d'etat there, and then I was asked to go to South Africa as the ambassador. That probably was the greatest challenge that I've ever had in my life. As the president called me in and spent an hour at least with me, asked me if I wanted to go. I said, well, if the president wants to send me, then I want to go. He said, well, if I send you, what are you going to do? I said, well, Mr. President, I think you know that the black people in South Africa think you are anti-black. You don't care for them. And I'm going to try to disabuse them of that. In other words, sir, I'm going to try to use your office to bring about change in South Africa. He seemed amused by that. So he said, well, how are you going to do it? And I said, I will visit as many members of the African National Congress as I can and other elements in South Africa. And I will tell them, the United States stands for this because of our Constitution and that we are trying to make it happen every day. He said, what else will you do? And I said, I will visit as many of the black people as I can. And then he said, what about the white people? I said, Mr. President, I'll visit them too. That's because what we are working for is a unified country. And it will not come out of the degradation that it's in now unless it's unified. He said, okay, Mr. Pastor. Then he said, where did you come from in the United States? I said, well, I was born in Louisiana. He said, well, where? I told him. He said, you know, maybe you might do. You probably had some experience like this. I said, I've had a lot of experience, Mr. President. And he said, what? So I told him about some of the instances I've had, including a couple here in Pine Bluff, which was all white racism. But I said, I also learned that you never let one incident or even two incidents determine the fate of your life, of how you're going to proceed. You kick, you throw up, and you keep marching on, because you're a better person if you could do that and make it stick. So ultimately, you will do something like accept an appointment that you know is going to be the most difficult thing you've ever done in your life. And that will make sure that you can do it. What's better than that? So all of these elements made it possible for me to be a much better foreign service officer. The kind of receptions I've gotten in places where I serve have made it possible for me to say that I am both a foreign service officer, a great Marine, and a citizen of the United States. Let me close this by saying these things. I don't think you will ever know everything that you ought to know. But I think it's important that you remember that every waking moment is a learning moment. You also should learn that if you're not learning something, you'll be sleepy, you'll be tired, you'll be dissatisfied with yourself. I was, and I'm no different. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. You're no different than anyone else. I urge you to remember that one learns every day in one way or another. If you're not happy learning, then you ought to go back to bed. Let me end my little soliloquy tonight by talking about the American Foreign Service. One of the appointments I had was as Director General of the American Foreign Service. I was looking to make the Foreign Service better. The appointment was made by George Bush I. When he asked me what I was going to do in the Foreign Service, I said, I'm going to try to change the Foreign Service to make it a much more representative service of the United States of America. That I wanted those who represent us to represent the United States as well. So, all right, we'll see. During my 3 years as Director General, my job was to bring into the Foreign Service an equal number, representationally, of all people who could represent the population of the United States, and that the kind of training that we gave Foreign Service officers, I wanted that part of the training to be the kind of training that would prepare people to represent the United States as a nation still growing, and that whatever was done as a diplomat, as a bureaucrat in Washington, or as a bureaucrat in state government was pointed only one way, and that was the way of making our country a better place. Sometimes things happen and they are things that you never expected. My last vignette before I stop talking is this. When David Warren, who was president of the University of Oklahoma, called me in Canberra, South Africa, not South Africa, but Canberra, Australia, and said, by my reckoning, it's time for you to think about retiring from the Foreign Service. I said, Mr. President, you must have read my mind. I'm getting ready to do that. He said, well, how about coming to the University of Oklahoma? I said, well, to do what? He said, I want you to help me construct a college of international relations I want to see people from the Midwest and adjacent states come into the Foreign Service and make sure that it represents this part of the country. I did. The college was built. And now the Foreign Service is getting a plethora of applicants from the Midwest, many of them coming through the University of Oklahoma. But I want to see more than that. I want to see a Foreign Service that represents what the United States stands for. It stands for a nation made up of people who represent the United States. That must be true, otherwise we'll be on the downslope as it comes. I want a Foreign Service that represents all citizens, represents women, minorities, and others. I want a Foreign Service that will have its women officers recognized immediately when I say which amendment of the Constitution gave women the right to vote. I want to hear an answer.
Thank you.
It's important that we say to those that we intersect with, that the 19th Amendment is an amendment that changed the way we look at citizens. I want a Foreign Service that says the slave amendments, 12, 13, and 14, made it possible for others to claim citizenship. But every time we think about these amendments, make them work, we become stronger. My last comment is about Nelson Mandela. I met a lot of people in my role as a Foreign Service officer. Fortunately for me, Mandela was on the verge of getting out of Pol's War prison in South Africa. My first action in South Africa as ambassador was to go and see the Justice Minister and ask to see Nelson Mandela. Of course, I was refused. And so I said to the jailer, the Attorney General, Kobe Kutsia was his name, I said, you know, Mandela is going to be so strong in jail that you can't keep him there. He said, oh, come on, Ambassador. You don't know what you're talking about. Well, a year later, I was witness to Mandela inking a contract with the government saying, I will walk out on this date and no earlier. And that's what happened. I went back to South Africa once, just before the election took place. And Kobe Kutsia asked the then ambassador to invite me to lunch. And before he sat down, he said, Mr. Ambassador, I want to confess to you that if I said something that uttered that Kobe Kutsia, was a little bit naive, I apologize. I said, in other words, I'm really apologizing for you not saying to me, I told you so. I think as American citizens and those who come here and study, who are not citizens, but who become citizens, it is a privilege that I've enjoyed beyond explanation. To have someone say, Perkins is an American citizen, is a good thing. It raises me up beyond all activities. Lastly, you will get questions sometimes. And you'll say, what party do you belong to? when I was getting ready to go to South Africa, the president had interviewed me and said, I think you'll do. You go on back to post. And I will take care of it in my own way, in my own time. So don't tell anybody in the State Department what I've said. And I did, went back to Monrovia. And that night, I got a call, telephone call, from the White House, from the personnel office at the White House. And she said, well, Mr. Best, I want to thank you for coming by the White House to see us. Well, we forgot to ask you one question. I said, well, what's that? She said, we forgot to ask you what party you're registered with. I said, did President Reagan ask you to call me and ask me that question? She said, no, he didn't, but it's a routine question. I said, well, if President Reagan wants to know, he'll probably call me. Now, that's it.
Ambassador Perkins, that was an inspirational message, and I'm so happy that we had this audience here to listen to you. If you leave here with nothing other than this, he is a living example and living proof that there are global opportunities for you out there. You can expand yourselves and extend yourselves beyond the boundaries of Pine Bluff, Arkansas. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Have a few moments for a couple of questions. Are there some pressing questions from the audience that you'd like to direct to Ambassador Perkins?
Thank you, Ambassador Perkins, for your very inspiring words. They really meant a lot to me, and I know a lot to the audience. I have two questions. The first question is, what was your biggest challenge when you moved from the United States to essentially living abroad? And what advice would you give to our young people about leaving the United States and living abroad to work with organizations like the Foreign Service? Thank you.
Thank you. One of the greatest challenges is leaving the United States and making sure that you know you're leaving the United States, but that you're going to represent the United States. That's probably one of the hardest challenges that anyone could face. And that means that you need to prepare for it all the time, because there'll be challenges to you. Something will happen in the United States. And then somebody will ask you, can your country still claim to be a great country and that this happened? And that question was asked of me many times in South Africa. And I answered the question this way. Yes, our Constitution is not yet perfect and will never be, but we're still working to make that a perfect example of how we govern ourselves. And that's going to continue. But then we need to say it out loud, often. And I did. I made sure that those working with me at the embassy were always equipped to give that kind of an answer to whomever queried them, to make sure that they didn't hesitate in saying, this is what I stand for under the Constitution of the United States. There was another question. What would I say to young people contemplating a career in the United States Foreign Service or other activities representing the United States? First, I'd say, don't hesitate if you have the chance, and step forward with glee and preparation. You're going to find that you don't always agree with what your government is doing. And if that's so, then I think you have to find out how you can make a difference by suggesting perhaps a change or explaining it in a different way. Never, ever give up on a foreign policy, on a domestic policy question. And don't hesitate to write the president. I had one encounter with a president who appointed me an ambassador to Australia. His last name was Clinton. When I met the president, he was entertaining the Prime Minister of Australia. And he said, Mr. Prime Minister, we think a lot of our relationship with you. And we're to prove we're right, that we mean it. We're sending you one of our best career officers. Says, when you want to talk to me, talk to Ed Perkins. Whatever he asks of me, and with a recommendation, chances are I will do it. And that'll be your answer. Never once did the president turn me down. And several times I had to call his office because I couldn't get the right answer out of the State Department. And he would make sure someone called me back within 3 or 4 minutes. That's what we call representation, I think. Yes, sir?
Yes, my question was, what was one of your favorite articles from your book and why?
Well, one of my favorite parts of the book is growing up in Louisiana. I tell why, and why is because my grandmother and grandfather had an unusual position. They owned a pretty big farm. They had 10 children. My grandmother made all of 10 children go to college. Only 2 finished. And then she made sure they left their books on the farm with her. So when one of the young people turned up like me, my job was to get those books out every day and learn something. And she would have me tested by my spinster aunt. Sit down.
All right, Ambassador Perkins, thank you for your speech for tonight, this evening. And I would like to ask you how, if you could do it over again, would you do the thing that you did?
I would emphasize even more how important it is to be prepared by understanding those things that you do not normally get trained in. And the other would be understanding languages. Nobody's asked me about the study of languages, but let me tell you. The languages that I formally studied and passed an examination in was French, and German and Russian. These are European languages. But esoterically, I also learned a couple of languages, Thai and Japanese, and the ancillary parts of Chinese. My wife was Chinese, and her 2 children have learned Chinese. My 2 daughters are now of age, and they have children. I have 4 grandchildren. All of them study Chinese, and the oldest grandchildren study Japanese, and they've traveled to these countries in the summertime to study. So language is one of the most important things that you can do to study, to prepare you to understand the people of the nation where you are accredited. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. My question was, while you were in the services, what inspired you to enter foreign relations?
That was what inspired me to enter the foreign service. I was very interested in the world at large and what would make it possible for me to be a different kind of a person. I had just finishing a book called The Explanation of the Silk Road. It's an ancient book. It talks about how the Chinese manipulated the Silk Road to make money going through Persia up to Mongolia. So it's important to understand that part of it. And that part of it was perhaps one of my most favorite elements. But to know something, to know how it works. One more example of it. When I was being interviewed by the professors at the University of Oklahoma Political Science Department as to my fitness to be a professor, one professor said, "Well, one more question, Mr. Pastor. If you had a chance to recommend two books for your students to read, which ones would they be?" He fully expected me to mention some Western authors. So I said, Sun Tzu, The Art of War, and A Book of Five Rings by Miyamoto Musashi. I got no more questions after that. Yes, sir.
Ambassador Perkins, thank you for your speech tonight. But my question will be, growing up a man of color with many trials and tribulations that were placed before you, what would be the legacy that you would want to leave behind once you move on to glory?
The legacy would be that the United States is probably one of the strongest nations on earth because we have a diverse population. And that population should be reiterated all the time. An example is this. When I was in South Africa, and after apartheid had begun crumbling, then we knew that Nelson Mandela was going to come out of jail and that my job was essentially over. The Swiss ambassador was the chairman of the board for foreign ambassadors. And so it was up to him to give a party in my honor and the honor of my wife as we got ready to leave. And in his speech, he said, "Well, Mr. Ambassador, you're an unusual person and probably could only come from the United States." He said, "When we heard you were coming, and this is a black ambassador, we all said among ourselves as the Europeans, we took a bet as to how long it would take you to get kicked out of the country." And then we sat and waited, and we heard nothing. 6 months went by, and we began to inquire, is this guy here? We found that you were traveling all over the country, having sit-down suppers with people that we'd never met before. And you had made inroads into the countryside. He said, "That could only happen in the United States." He said, "We're so hidebound in Europe. We won't do things like that. Only you would have the dare to do it. And the proof is in the pudding. Things are happening now. So your country is fortunate to have a kind of a structure which says we can do it, even though there are some people who don't want you to do it." I might as well leave you with this vignette. When I began to make inroads into the apartheid system, I also began to get a lot of hate mail coming into the United States, into the State Department. So one day the security officer brought me a letter written someplace, I don't know what it is. And he said, Mr. Ambassador, do we investigate this and see who wrote this? I looked at it. And I said, no, we'll lock it up in the safe. And somebody will give themselves away, according to this group. I'm trying to figure out a way to tell you what it was. But I'll just quote it, hoping that you'll understand that I'm quoting it because I want you to understand what lower levels people will go to satisfy themselves. The letter came to me, addressed to me, and said, quote, Mr. Ambassador, issue is, or issue a, jigabo, quote unquote. And, so the security officer said, what do we do? I said, lock it up. I said, if somebody had the nerve to write that without putting their name at the bottom of it, that person is the one that's suffering. Not me.
Thank you, Ambassador Perkins. I'm sure all of you were enthralled with all that he had to say, and I'm sure that if there are further questions, we will be around for just a few minutes. But we do have some presentations that we'd like to make, and I'd like to start, first of all, with Chancellor Alexander.
Thank you, Dr. Perkins. I'm going to ask Mr. Henry Linton to join me up here. Mr. Linton, come on down. Ambassador Perkins, while we are aware that you left here in 1945, we are presenting you from our museum archives. This is our museum director, Mr. Linton. Our museum archives, a copy of Merrill High's yearbook from 1945-46, wow. The Marillion. Uh-huh. It contains photos of administrators, faculty, staff, and students during your years at Merrill. I hope this publication will bring to mind many of the fond memories that you have of Merrill High and Pine Bluff, Arkansas.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
It goes without saying, I repeat, my years at Merrill High School left me just with a learning curve that cannot be repeated. It stayed with me all these years, and I'm glad it's continuing now that I'm here tonight amongst you. Thank you very much, sir.
Good evening. My name is Naisha Aldridge. I'm the CEO of the Boys and Girls Club of Jefferson County. And I have two awards to present to you, Ambassador Perkins. I'm going to start with the Arkansas Traveler Certificate. I am presenting this award on behalf of Mark Martin, Secretary of State. Arkansas have long been known for their hospitality and their love of their beautiful state. The certificate expressed the state's regard for individuals whose contributions to the progress, enjoyment, or well-being of the state of Arkansas merit special recognition. The story behind the Arkansas Traveler is simple. While traveling through the Arkansas backcountry in the early 19th century, Colonel Sandy Faulkner, tired and hungry, came upon a humble squatter cabin. He found the occupant sitting in the doorway playing the first part of a familiar tune over and over on an old fiddle. Faulkner stopped and asked for accommodation. The squatter offered none. When Faulkner asked why he played the same part of the tomb over and over, the squatter replied that he didn't know the rest. While Faulkner played the turn of the tomb, the squatter changed his mind in making the traveler royally welcome for as long as he pleased. Like that song, like that long ago traveler, we hope that you have had a good visit, enjoy our stay, share your own turn of the tomb with us, and always have nice things to say and good stories to tell about Arkansas.
Thank you very much. And we'll always have great stories to tell. Especially from some of those that I've heard tonight. Thank you.
At this time, I would like to present a Senate citation on behalf of Senator Stephanie Flowers. She sent her regrets that she could not be with us this evening. It reads, whereas Ambassador Edward J. Perkins of Washington, D.C., who retired in 1996 after an illustrious career in the Foreign Service, will return for a visit to Pine Bluff, where he attended Merrill High School as a teenager and where he credits his teachers with instilling in him the pursuit of excellence that has shaped his life and career successes. And whereas, after serving his country in the U.S. Army and Marine Corps, he earned bachelor's, master's, and doctorate degrees and enjoyed a career that included numerous Department of State and Foreign Service positions and appointments by three presidents as ambassador to Liberia, South Africa, the United Nations, and Australia. And whereas, in recognition to his exemplary service, Ambassador Perkins has received numerous prestigious awards and honorary degrees from a lengthy list of educational and service-connected organizations, and continues to share his wealth of knowledge and experience as a member and advisor of profession-related groups. And whereas, the members of the Arkansas Senate wish to join Senator Stephanie Flowers in welcoming Ambassador Edward J. Perkins to the Senate of Arkansas and expressing pride in the knowledge that his time at Merrill High School played a role in his career successes. Now, therefore, pursuant to the motion of Senator Stephanie Flowers, the Arkansas Senate directs that this citation be presented on this sixth day of August, 2015.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Ambassador Perkins, we have a similar award from the House of Representatives presented to us from Representative Vivian Flowers and Kenneth Ferguson, who happen both to be from Pine Bluff. So on their behalf, I'm very pleased to present to you another citation, this one from the House of Representatives.
Thank you very much, and that's my regards to representatives of the people. Thank you.
And now Judge Dutch King has a presentation he'd also like to make on behalf of the city.
Ken. You know, I like to talk from the heart. This one, Ambassador Perkins is an amazing person. You need to read his biography. I've read it three times. I've got a proclamation, and it does not do him justice because he's got more accolades, more honors, more awards. He's done more things than probably all of us in this room put together. He is truly, truly a legend. And we are honored to have you here in Pine Bluff, Ambassador Perkins. And it's my privilege and honor to read this proclamation. Whereas Ambassador Edward J. Perkins was born in Sterlington in Washtenaw Parish in North Louisiana, the son of Edward Joseph Perkins Sr. and Tiny Estella Noble Holmes. He grew up in Pine Bluff, Arkansas and Portland, Oregon. He earned his BA from the University of Maryland, his MA and Doctors of Public Administration from the University of Southern California. He is an active member of Kappa Alpha Psi fraternity and holds the highest honor the fraternity bestows its members, the Laurel Wreath Award. He And whereas Ambassador Perkins served in the United States Army, the Marine Corps, he was appointed ambassador to Liberia in 1985. In 1986, was appointed ambassador to South Africa under President Ronald Reagan. In 1992, he was appointed ambassador to the United Nations and U.S. representative to the U.N. Security Council under President George W. Bush. In 1993, he was appointed representative to the Commonwealth of Australia under President Bill Clinton before retiring at the rank of career minister in the United States Foreign Service. And whereas Ambassador Perkins taught at the University of Oklahoma, where he served as Senior Vice Provost Emeritus of International Programs at the International Program Center and Professor Emeritus of the School of International Area Studies. And whereas Ambassador Perkins has a long resume of education, experience, and honors to which are so well deserved because of his service and dedication to the United States of America. Now, therefore, I, Jefferson County Judge Dutch King, along with the Jefferson County Quorum Court members, the citizens of Jefferson County, family, and friends, come today to honor and celebrate the years of service and dedication that Ambassador Perkins has given to our country. It is my honor to declare August 6, 2015, as Ambassador Edward J. Perkins Day in Jefferson County. God bless you and thank you.
Thank you very much for that honor. And I accept all of these with a great deal of honor and humility.
And now, Ambassador Perkins, your brothers of Kappa Alpha Psi fraternity wish to make a presentation. Mr. Archie Sanders. And Mr. Danny Campbell. And all the other brothers.
Good evening. My name is Archie Sanders, where I serve as pomark of this chapter of President. And we are so happy that all of you came out for our good brother. One thing this brother holds that all of us would love to hold, he wears the laurel wreath. The laurel wreath is the highest achievement thing that you can get in Kappa Alpha Psi. And we are truly proud of him. You know, when we first started, we were trying to say, wow, this brother, what do we give him who has had all these awards? So we started thinking, just so happened, we have a brother in our chapter that, Brother Campbell, who happens to be the chair of the arts department here, happens to have went through Gamma Sigma of Pine Bluff, and we told him we needed something that this brother, when he came to Pine Bluff, and when he left, he would know he had been here. So this time, I'm going to ask Brother Campbell if he'd come and tell him, look, and I'll let you decide if you think he'll remember this.
Good evening.
Good evening.
On behalf of Kappa Alpha Psi, Pine Bluff, Arkansas, I want to present to you another token. I know that you've received many awards tonight and honors, but I can bet you $1 million that you have not received an honor such as this.
Ah. Turn around. Let's see it.
I am very honored tonight. I'm a mixed media artist, and my wife is from a little town, Strong, Arkansas, which is next to Marion, where you grew up from.
Mm-hmm.
And the piece combines tie treads, and I'm a recycling artist, and the tie tread represents the worn and erosions of life.
Mm-hmm.
That you have been persistent over the years. We thank you, and God bless you.
Thank you, sir.
We thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. You have been an outstanding, attentive, and intimate audience. I'm sure he felt very comfortable among us. That's UAPP hospitality. We're gonna close the program out with a few recognitions, and I'm probably going to miss somebody. But I'm sorry, I'm trying to, you can't hear me. in the back doing this, so that's my cue. We're going to acknowledge a few people before we leave and thank some others. I'd like to recognize Dr. Gwendolyn Michael from Georgetown University, who is traveling with Ambassador Perkins. Welcome to Pine Bluff, Dr. Michael. I also saw in the audience Mr. Jerome Green from Shorter College. Welcome. Welcome home to you as well. Now, I don't have my glasses, so I didn't see everybody. But if there are any other elected or retired elected officials, would you please stand and let us welcome you? Elected officials. There are a lot of you. Yes. Yes, thank you for being here. Thank you for being here. We appreciate that.
My name is Judge Leon Jameson, and Ambassador Perkins is my second cousin. So I want to let you know I have some strong roots.
I'd also like to recognize the Chancellor's team, and I'm talking about the cabinet. Would you stand, please? The Chancellor's team. There you are, on the walls and all around. Thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen. Yes.
Good evening. I also want to welcome Chancellor Perkins on behalf of the University of Arkansas Board of Trustees. I am a member of the Board of Trustees, and also extend my congratulations to your long distinguished career. As a graduate also of this university, I also want to let the young people know here that I'm multitasking right now, because not only am I a member of Kappa Alpha Psi fraternity and a graduate of this university, I also am a member of Sigma Pi Phi fraternity, which is Pi Boulet. And I want to recognize Dr. Roosevelt Brown over here, who has been a Sar Archon of that fraternity for a number of years. Our own chancellor here is a member of that fraternity as well, and Mr. Lynn, who has done all of this and brought this event together, is also a member of Pi Boulet. I am currently the Sar Archon of Pi Boulet, and we welcome you as well.
Thank you for sharing that with us, Dr. Broughton. I don't think we have any, Chancellor, do we have any other announcements or any recognitions that we need to make? I just want to say again that you've been a wonderful audience. Thank you so much. I hope you enjoyed yourself. I hope you learned something. And I hope you will remember some of the things that he said. Remember, he said, know yourself, students. Ambassador Perkins said, be sure to know yourself. And he also said, be sure to be able to extend respect to others. Good evening.